Hello and welcome. I'm Afreen Kidwai, Editor-in-Chief of SolidWasteIndia.com. And with me is Mr. Masood Malik, Joint Managing Director of Ramke Enviro Engineers. Ramke Enviro, as most of you are probably aware, is a full-service waste management company working on all aspects of the waste ecosystem, including waste collection, transportation, treatment, disposal, and recycling. Mr. Malik, it's a pleasure to have you with us. I know it's been a busy time, and there is a lot of pressure on existing urban service providers like health, transport, waste management, to adapt to these new change needs of our society. So I'd like to begin by asking you, as one of the biggest players in India in waste management, what are your observations on how has solid waste generation habits, patterns, statistics changed in the last 2.5 months?
Yeah, thanks, Afreen. Thank you for this opportunity to share my thoughts with you. The fact is that what we do has probably never been more important than it is today. And waste generation, that trends that we have seen across the country actually reflect the socioeconomic composition of the catchment. So in the bigger cities, in the urban centers, the large urban centers, we are seeing that the composition is changing because of shutdown of commercial establishments and some of the bulk generators like restaurants or cinema halls, etc., are no longer generating the waste that they were generating. In the small cities, actually the impact is lesser, and the waste composition has not changed very dramatically. If I talk about biomedical waste, then again, it was the smaller healthcare establishments, the clinics, the nursing homes, etc., they were shut down during the significant portion of this lockdown period. And therefore, that waste was not getting generated. In our estimate, that's about 30% of the biomedical waste generation capacity of a particular city or a catchment. And we did not get that waste during this period. Industrial waste obviously did get impacted very significantly during this period. And as industries started coming back on, first the essential industries and then other industries, we have seen waste quantities come back on. Across municipal, biomedical, and industrial, I would say that we're still not at 100% of pre-lockdown waste generation quantities. We're probably at around 90%.
Now that people will come out of their houses, now that waste generation numbers, commercial establishments will open up, private clinics will open up, there's going to be a huge amount of waste that your existing infrastructure will have to cope with. So how are you getting up for that?
I think the response to that is through having a sort of a tiered approach. And right now we're at the first tier of response, which is COVID waste being responded to and treated by traditional biomedical waste infrastructure and capacities.
Yeah.
If that was to be exceeded, the current policies allow for that waste to be handled by common industrial hazardous waste incinerators. Now, just to illustrate, a typical biomedical waste incinerator is between 100 to 250 kilograms per hour operating capacity. So it can deal with 100 to 250 kilograms per hour of waste. An industrial waste incinerator of the types that we operate is 1.5 tons per hour. So there's an order of magnitude capacity arbitrage between a biomedical waste incinerator and an industrial waste incinerator. They operate at the same temperature and they have the same environmental controls and therefore there's no dilution of the treatment efficiency, so to speak. The next level would be if, for example, what we saw in China, where suddenly the waste quantities became 6 times, yeah, and industrial waste infrastructure was not there in those cities, they took it to waste energy plants. Mm. And the waste energy plants, incidentally, would operate at 1,200 tons a day, 1,500 tons a day, that level of waste processing capacity they have.
Yeah.
So there is, I think, there are tiers of capacity that are there with the right policy framework and the right environmental controls. I think the country is ready to deal with COVID-19 waste.
You mentioned waste-to-energy plants in China, which kind of came to rescue in that country. India does not have that kind of waste-to-energy infrastructure. What is your opinion on waste-to-energy as being the need of the hour?
Very precious acres and areas of land are being consumed today by this waste. And the mountains that we keep hearing about and keep seeing will continue to grow till the time we find solutions that will recover as much as possible of recoverable value from these wastes, either by way of recycling, which I think is reasonably efficient, both using the formal and the informal sort of collections systems that exist in India. But what do you do with the rest? And I think that is really where waste to energy comes in. It is the last mile in terms of resource recovery. But the other aspect, so it's not just the fact that you're getting a clean energy from waste. The fact that you take a quantity of waste and reduce it to a much lower volume and in a form that occupies much less land. And that too, there's potential to recover and recycle it ever more. I think it is for those set of reasons why waste to energy is so critical for India's future.
So could you tell us a bit more about Ramki's waste to energy projects in India? You all have one in Delhi that's functional. What about your other projects?
Yeah, so we have, we are about to commission our second plant, which is ready here in Hyderabad. This will be approximately 20 megawatts in capacity. We have three other waste to energy projects in development in this part of the world itself, around in and around Hyderabad. In addition to that, we have projects in development in central India, northern India, and one location in eastern India. So together, we are in the process of developing about 150 megawatts of installed capacity in waste energy immediately. And we have a very clear vision and plans of taking it to 400, 500 megawatts in the next 4 to 5 years.
In fact, in January, Ramki had announced very ambitious plans to triple its revenue over the next 3 years through new projects, through global expansion. What do you see changing for Ramki in the near future?
Yes, there were challenges and there are challenges around business continuity. We remain very vigilant about the health, safety and well-being of our own workforce. But I believe the corona issue has been, like it has been a seminal event for our times, it is a seminal chapter in our own evolution, in our own journey as an organization as well. One, we think it brings the whole sustainability debate to the forefront in a manner that has never come before.
Yeah.
And as an environmental company, as a company that started 25 years ago, exactly with this intent and vision, it's about time. It's about time that this that we take this issue and give it the importance that it deserves. That's our first observation on this issue. The second is that whilst there would be a lot of challenges, the fact that we have to continue operating and the fact that we have to keep managing as an essential service all the waste that our clients, our communities, our catchments generate is an absolute given for us.
Mm.
And that imperative, more than the commercial realities and the impacts, is what is driving us today. This is not the time to really look at commercial interest. The time to ensure that will come. Today, we have to respond. And that's exactly what we have been doing. Finally, the longer term response to a post-COVID world, I think that sanitation, waste management, recycling, resource recovery, the concept of circular economy, and in general, being more conscious of our waste footprint, water footprint, carbon footprint, is the future. So if that is the future, then we actually look forward to it.
What has been your biggest learning as a, you know, environment expert, as a waste expert? Is there one takeaway from this whole 2 months that, you know, will probably drive your thinking as an industry leader in the future?
As a student of this for the last several decades, I can tell you that the one realization that I'm walking away with from the last 2 or 3 months is a sense of amazement about our frontline workers. Somehow I had thought or I had assumed that it would be difficult to get so many people to come to work at a time like this. Somehow I had felt that the same hesitation and fear that I felt leaving home, they would also feel. The way they responded, the sense of pride with which they donned their uniforms and their personal protective gear, the sense of purpose which drives how they are out on the streets every day, the sense of purpose and pride that has been a huge learning for me.
In fact, you'll put out a campaign, a video, you know, kind of acknowledging that the work they're doing, which I think is worth commending. So thank you very much, Mr. Malik, for taking the time out to talk to us. It's been a pleasure. You always have so many insights, and all the very best with your work. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Stay safe.
You too.